Welcome to another edition of Voice of the Diaspora. We have a very, very special guest here in studio, of course, virtually with me. I'm your host, Norman Brown. We have thespian and broadcaster, Ron Bobb Semple. Ron Bobb Semple is Guyanese who is residing abroad in the United States of America. But he has a very illustrious track record in film and in theater. And so he will be joining me now, and we will be talking about his journey in film and theater. Ron Bobb Semple, welcome to Voice of the Diaspora.
Greetings, and thank you, Brother Norman, for inviting me to be a part of your broadcast.
Wonderful, wonderful. It's very, you know, I try my best to bring Guyanese, notable Guyanese to my viewers on social media, and my viewers span, you know, a lot of young people, middle age and so on, you know. So I try my best to ensure that my viewers get an opportunity to meet notable Guyanese and to know what they are doing. And I am really, really pleased and honored to have you on. I want to thank you very much for accepting and for taking the time to be here. But let us rock on. You started out your acting in theater in the late 60s in Guyana at the Theater Guild. Wonderful. And you have moved on to travel the world and so on, which we'll talk about. But before, just give us a little snippet or a synopsis of those times in the 60s, that time in the 60s when you would have been performing at the Theater Guild in Georgetown.
Well, professionally, Norman, it started at the Theater Guild, but the spark got a hold of me in high school, at the Central High School. And my English teacher, I always give her the props, Miss Lucille Hall, she's now Mrs. Lucille Harper. She always picked on me, I should say, to read in front of the class, because I did have that propensity to project, and I should say I was one of her favorite students, and she would call me in front of the class, you know, to read aloud, and I think that's where I developed that confidence to be in front of X amount of individuals. And I was also a member of the drama group there at Central High School with my good buddy Hubert Devenish and others. And there was an ad seeking actors at the Theater Guild. And I took the opportunity, I went and I auditioned, and I was selected. And that's where my really serious approach to theater was launched there at the Theater Guild back in 1968.
Wonderful, wonderful. And of course, you would have rubbed shoulders during those days with other persons, notable persons in the arts, who such as Ron Robinson, I think, and Francis Kwamana Faria. And some of those are the great names. Just give us a little, what were they like? What were those days like? And so on, you know.
Well, there's the days, you know, Clement Tate and as you mentioned, Francis Kwamana Faria, there's a Ricardo Smith. We performed in the Rogues Trial that was written and directed by Paulo de Paulo out of Brazil. And an enlightening experience, you know, to be working with Mark Matthews. You know, he was also a member of the cast, and also performed in a couple of Francis Kwamana Faria's plays, Manaka, and a few of the Brink shows. And one of my first productions there at Theater Guild was Winslow Fraser's The Winds of Change. And okay. There I was, you know, me and a Black Power militant with a dashiki and afro. not knowing that in a few years afterwards, I'd be leaving for the United States. Not necessarily to be a Black Power militant.
But you have done well. You have earned your place in Guyanese history, and also you have earned your place perhaps on the world stage in terms of acting. You've done something that hasn't happened to me before. You know, while I was researching you and examining your stuff, I couldn't imagine the true image of Marcus Garvey in my head anymore, because the way you played him, and it was so surreal. It was absolutely beautiful. But what is most touching is your remarkable ability to retain. Well, I don't think I could retain 10 lines. And for you to have that body of work that you can stand on a stage and recite those lines is remarkable. How do you do it?
First of all, Norman, those are the words of Marcus Garvey. The majority of the words, they're speeches from all across the world. And initially, when I embarked on this, if you allow me to share with you,
go ahead,
how it started. I was attending a wedding in Brooklyn, and I'm sitting in the church there. It was Brooklyn and I can't remember the name of the club, on Union Street. And a young lady sitting in front of me looked at the stained glass window just to the right and saw the stained glass window image of Marcus Garvey. So she turned back and said, "Ron, you have a striking resemblance of Marcus Garvey." And I said, I had not known about Marcus Garvey then. And this was back in the 80s. Mm-hmm. So I felt that I owed it to myself as an artist, and as well as respect to the organization that Garvey founded, the Universal Negro Improvement Association,
yes,
and African Communities League, to keep his name and his spirit, his ideologies and his philosophies alive in my own inimitable style. And I created this one-man cultural and educational presentation on Garvey, his sojourn in the United States between 1916 and 1925. Initially, it was just about 8 or 9 minutes long, and then it ballooned up to about an hour and a half. And then I felt it was much too long, and I just kind of curtailed it, pulled it back to about 45 minutes, and then with Q&A. And I did that for just about 35 years.
And you have traveled the world. You've traveled Europe. You've traveled Africa, the Isles of the Caribbean, and so many places. You know, you have traveled, and I can imagine how popular it was. And that is owing to your performance, the way you would have delivered. Remarkable. Let us go to a brief clip of you as Marcus Mosiah Garvey on stage.
You know what history means, eh? History is the guidepost of a race. It's the inspiration for future generation either to stand still or to follow. To revenge, I'll be revenge. I had a motive and a purpose. It was a crying voice in the grave that said, "Gavin! For 250 years we have waited for this day and time. We expect something from you at this hour." The prejudice against us as an African people is not because of our color, it's because of our condition. If we must have justice, we must be strong. If we must be strong, we must come together. If we must come together, we can only do so through the system of organization. Because the fight for African redemption does not mean that you must give up your domestic rights. It does not mean that you must be disloyal to any government or country wherein you are born. Those of us who leave this country to go settle permanently in Africa will become pioneers. Pilgrim fathers of the new nation, you must make Africa
Africa a nation to which people can look for help and support, both morally and physically, when being ill-treated and abused for being black people.
Absolutely, absolutely brilliant. I can sense the energy there and the passion and the zeal. I don't know how you would have been able to do that, but it is absolutely remarkable. Well,
it's a transformation, Norman. But before I continue, that presentation, and I don't refer to it as a performance. I am a professional actor, but it's a presentation. And that was done at the New Orican Poets Cafe in Lower Manhattan.
Okay.
And I'd like to convey my sincere condolences to the family and the friends and the those who are close to Miguel Algarin, you know, who is the founder of the New Orican Poets Cafe in Lower Manhattan, who made his transition last month. And my good buddy Rome Neal, who has been at Miguel's side for many, many years, and my condolences to his family. And yes, it's a transformation, Norman. You know, once I don that regalia, Ron Bobb Semple goes out the window,
mm-hmm.
and the spirit of Garvey just consumes me. Some nights, you know, I mean, things would be different, you know, I mean, depending on where my energy is, and it has been a wonderful journey.
Mm-hmm.
Where, like any journey, you know, there are pitfalls and there are ups and downs, but I as I mentioned, you know, I mean, I felt I owed it to myself as an artist and to the UNIA, the members of the UNIA, you know, to keep Garvey's spirit and his name and his ideologies alive, and I wanted to do it, you know, I mean, in the regalia, where he was more you know, popularly seen,
mm-hmm.
Wearing that regalia. So I tried to be as authentic as I could.
But perfect.
Yes.
Perfect, because you were on African TV doing a Garvey, you were introduced in Africa. It's so big in Africa. You're in Africa on African TV and doing Garvey, and it was another majestic performance. And before we move on to our next topic, let us have a look at you performing on African TV.
And now you are in for a very special treat. We're going to go back in time and listen to the person for whom this program is dedicated, to the legendary Marcus Garvey, coming to you in the person of Mr. Ron Bobb Semple. Mr. Semple, this is a very special presentation.
Brothers and sisters, good evening. Sisters and brothers, good evening. The black race is one of the branches of the human race. As a section of humanity, he occupies the position in the world at the present time most uncomfortable and most unfavorable. Black people are subjects of ostracism. It is sad that our humanity has shown us no more love, no greater sympathy than we're experiencing. Wherever you go throughout the world, the black man is discarded, is ostracized, is relegated to the lowest and things, social, political, and economical. This therefore suggests a problem and one that must be solved. We in this section of the world are not entirely free from this unkind and unsympathetic behavior among the groups or races around us. But since man has been placed on his own responsibility, whether he be black, white, or yellow, he must act in his own account. We will not unduly whine or complain, but reason among ourselves and see what can be done to remedy this state of affairs. Life is a conflict. You have to fight your way through it, whether you will it or not. Those of us who fight most stubbornly live, and to them go the laurels, the palms, and the triumph of our civilization and world. We unfortunately have not been trained to the truths of life, paradoxically so. May I say something to you tonight to give you a true understanding of yourself, so that the same glory and success attained by others who understand themselves would also be yours.
Wonderful. So was that done in Africa, or you done it on African TV in the United States at a function?
Yes, African TV was done in Atlanta, Georgia.
Oh, it was in Atlanta, so I stand corrected. Yes. Yeah, but, yes, it was beautiful. Tell us a little about that.
The television crew, they captured it. Yes, it was a mind blowing night.
Okay, so I know that you are presently occupying yourself a lot with you've got an international podcast. The information is up on my screen, so anyone watching the program now, which is live via Facebook at the moment, it's streaming live via Facebook, they will see the information in which they can log into your podcast. And so I made sure that was advertised there and so on, because we have to share the space. You know, we have to really share the space. And I want my younger audience to connect with you too, and to see another aspect of those who have gone before us in arts and in culture, something that I'm pushing very hard and advocating for as an opinion shaper, an activist, to see that develop in Guyana. You know, our country is a very rich country now. We have billions of barrels of oil, and I'm really, really pushing hard. We push a lot in the area of education, academic, and so on, but we have got a lot of talent down there, and we need to push for industries in arts and culture, film, and in music, and so on. And so I've been advocating strongly on that. A lot of young people at Linden and across Guyana, they are they're trying their utmost, and I would like to know that we can have that kind of connection. And so on. I know you have done a lot of acting, as we know. You were in you are in the movie See You yesterday. I saw that movie, I think it's about 2 years ago or a year ago. And I watched it about three times. I'm not making it up, Ron. I watched it about three times. And you made me laugh so much, right? Because I thought I didn't know who you were. But the thing that touched me caused me to crack up, because I thought like it was could have been any actor playing a Guyanese, person, a granddad, and so on. But I laughed because I used to wear short jacks back in the day, and it touched my soul because this is a Spike Lee movie, and of course it was directed by Stephen Bristol, who is of Guyanese parentage.
Yes,
Stefan is of Guyanese parents. That's Stefan there. Very humble, very nice person. And he directed that movie. But it was so Ron. Listen, I laughed at the scene because the way you said to the boy, "We just done. You suck your teeth." You know, and it was so great. It was really Guyanese, and let us have a quick look at the clip. Let us have a quick look at that clip, and then we'll talk a bit about it.
What's the business?
Hey, Grandpa.
Hey, Mr. Thomas.
Glad you got home. Need help in the lawn today?
Yeah, we just got back here. We have a lot of work to do. Expo's next week.
So we're on a really tight deadline.
Hello. You guys just can't be hanging around the garage like this all the time. It is not healthy for your brain, you know?
Yeah, we know. We've been working on this for about a year, so just give a little more time.
Look, it'll get us to college.
There'll be scholarships.
Scholarships?
Yes.
Really? Uh-huh. I like that. I do. Or is it that you two just like being together alone too much, eh? Listen, Sebastian. Expo's next week, right?
Yeah.
Yes, you have enough time to finish whatever it is that you're doing. After that, you're going to get yourself a proper summer job, right? Can't have you in this garage all summer, boy. Make sense? 1 week. Story done. Was that why you suck your teeth?
No.
Eh? Because you won't get a hole in your teeth. Eh?
You must you won't get a hold of it. And that's typical Guyanese. It's really, really a status symbol, I will think. And I admire your humbleness, your humility and so on. It's Thank really
you. But before you continue, Norman, You mentioned it, Stefan Bristol, you know, whose parents are Guyanese, who directed it. Stefan also co-wrote that film.
Wow.
With Frederica Bailey. Yes, they were students together at NYU Film School, and they had actually produced a documentary. You know, I mean, wow. the same name, See You Yesterday. And they shopped it around. They took it to Spike Lee, and they wanted to, you know, to make it into a full length movie, and they did many rewrites, as is done in this industry, and Spike Lee, you know, with his influence, you know, they took it to Netflix, and they bought it, and it just took off.
Spike Lee is one of the greatest directors and producers of all time. I can say that, you know, without any water in my mouth. I so love Spike Lee movies and so on. I, you know what I mean? If Jungle Fever all the way down to Malcolm X and you know, brilliant, absolutely brilliant. The thing is that I feel so proud as a patriotic Guyanese to see my people, our people, in the mainstream of America doing great things, to see a Guyanese in a movie such as See You Yesterday. And, you know, I want to say to Stefan how proud I am of him, and I want to say to you how proud I am. And I hope that this can inspire the young people in Guyana to know that, you know, wherever we are in the world, we can hold our own. Tell me a little about...
Second time. Mm-hmm. Yes, no, go ahead, go ahead.
No, tell me a little about your experience doing the movie, or, you know, hanging out with Stefan. I don't know if you met Spike Lee. You know, just give us a little background.
Okay, before I go there, mm-hmm. for the second time you mentioned young people, and I must big you up for doing that and focusing on young people.
Thank you.
Because it's imperative that we uplift our young people and expose them. I had the opportunity, I don't know if you have, I viewed the Guyana Drama Festival 2020, mm-hmm. that was recently held in Guyana. And it was shared with me by my dear friend, Margaret Lawrence.
Okay.
And to see the work that those young people did, you know, the content, the quality, even the production was extremely well done. But getting back to See You Yesterday, and if I can just put it in perspective as to how I was able to get involved. Mm-hmm. There was an ad, an audition ad out in I think it was the Caribbean Life newspaper out of Brooklyn, that they were looking for a Guyanese grandfather. And a good buddy of mine, Rocky Hall, who lives in Toronto, you know, I mean, saw the ad and called me and said, Bobo, you know, I mean, they're looking for a Guyanese actor, a Guyanese grandfather for a Spike Lee produced film. I said, okay. And with it, I submitted my picture resume, and I made a few phone calls. I got another call from my dear friend, Claire Goring, you know, who said, Ron, they're looking for this character. And, I have a contact for the casting director. I said, okay. So with that, you know, I mean, I submitted, as I said, my picture resume, and I called the director. And I mentioned to them that I was residing in Florida, and they agreed to have me put the audition on tape, which I did. And I had a meeting with Stefan Bristol. And a few days later, the casting director called me and asked me if I'm sitting. Now, a casting director calls you and asks you if you're sitting. That's nothing but good news. Yes, everybody from Spike Lee to Netflix, they're all impressed with what I did, and welcome aboard. You know, so I flew down there and. Up there, I should say, and they were shot in Brooklyn and in the Bronx. It was a really good experience, not only because Stefan Bristol, you know, I mean, he was born in the United States, but you know, he is a Guyanese parentage, as you mentioned. Mm-hmm. You know, that this young man is so passionate. And this was his first big film. Mm-hmm. You know, Netflix invested a whole lot of money. So, you know, I mean, he had to be up to mark and up to scratch.
Yeah.
Which he was. And yes, you know, he did a tremendous job.
Excellent.
You know, in the whole experience was just overwhelming. Yes, not only for me, but for other actors. And there was one other Guyanese in the film, Courtney Noel. Okay. He had a smaller part in the film, and just enjoyed working together. Yes.
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. I can imagine how elated you were and how overjoyed you would have been. But you have been the recipient of countless awards. I don't think I've known anyone who got so many awards, really, and it's deserved. It is absolutely well deserved. One of your big awards, I think, is the Odelco Award. Tell us a little bit about that. So you've got loads of the Government of Jamaica, United National Association, 1988 Marcus Garvey Award. My viewers can see it on the screen. Marcus Garvey Celebration Committee, Marcus Garvey Medal of Honor in 1991. Universal Negro Improvement Association, UNA Marcus Garvey Award, Jamaica 2016. And it goes on and on. You've got the Guyana's 38th Independence Anniversary Service and Humanitarian Award 2004. From Guyana Missions Consulate and the Guyana Tri-State Alliance. And it goes on, Ron. Tell me a little about that.
You know, when you're recognized by your, it makes a difference. You know, what I do is coming from my soul.
Mm-hmm.
And it's good to know that you're recognized for your work. You know, I mean, the whole longevity, because, you know, one of my mottos, Norman, mm-hmm. is that it takes a long time to be an overnight success. And I have, I've always put my best foot forward in whatever I do, not only just theatrically, because whatever you do affects. So it's a matter, because you'll never get a second opportunity to make a first impression. And it is good to know that, you know, not only in the Guyanese community that I've been recognized, you know, I mean, I was recognized in Jamaica, as you mentioned, in Costa Rica. I was there in 2017. And it is a good feeling, but, you know, I mean, I don't always just hang on those awards. You know, it's good to be, good to have that, you know, I mean, as part of your resume. But thank you for sharing that with your viewing audience.
Yeah, I must say thank you. Of course, you have been in a number of other movies. I would think a number of other films, and you would have done a number of other plays and so on. What are some of those films and?
I've done quite a few independent films that were produced by my good buddy Junior Smith, mm-hmm. wrote and directed The Clock in Green and Nursing Tuskegee, which had to do with the whole
Tuskegee experiment. Yeah,
right. Which is now in the news with those who are kind of leery about taking this vaccine. Remembering how these brothers were treated, you know, back in the 30s. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I did a film by my good, my Haitian filmmaker brother, Jean-René Ronville, a movie called En Passe. And I've done, which has given me, you know, I mean, quite a bit of exposure. And you know, in this industry, you know, you try to to do as much as you can and to be as well-rounded as you can.
There is that I would call it a play, and we're wrapping up now. I know I don't want to keep you up too late, but yeah, there is that. You've done Fences, haven't you?
Yes, well, August Wilson's Fences.
Right? Wilson's Fences.
I've done it. Yes, I've done it three times. Twice I did the character Bono, and the third time I did the character of Gabriel. And the first time I did it was with Avery Brooks, and he played the role of Troy Maxson. And that was done in Columbus, Ohio.
And that's and the Denzel Washington movie, Fences, is it the same storyline?
Yes, it's based on. Absolutely. Almost to the T.
Almost to the T.
Because, you know, Denzel Washington, he has decided, you know, to do all 10 of them. It's a cycle, right, for each decade that August Wilson wrote. But I've done 6 of the 10 plays.
You've done Gabriel on stage. And I would think, because I watched Fences, I honestly cried the first time I watched it. I recall on a very cold winter's night, I was coming home from work, and I was on a bus. I was traveling from London Bridge coming to South London, and I was watching it on my iPad, and, you know, it took like about an hour and a half for me to get from where I was coming from to get to South London. And Angela Davis and Denzel Washington together. look.
What a performance.
Tears literally came to my eyes, you know. It's brilliant acting. And of course, I watched a clip of you playing Gabriel once again. And we will wrap up, but I want my viewers to see how talented you are, and you know, and it's so great, you know, I'm so proud of your ability to perform in that way. Let's go to this clip.
You know what I got, Rose? I got some fruits and vegetables. We ain't got no plums today, Rose. I was just singing that. Have me some tomorrow. Put me in a big order for plums. Gonna have enough plums for St. Peter and everybody. Troy mad at me. I just moved over to Miss Pearl's to keep out from any way. I ain't mean no harm by it. You ain't mad at me, is you? Got me 2 rooms. In the basement. Got my own door, too. Want to see my key? That's my own key. Ain't nobody else got a key like that. Got my key.
Got my key. But quickly before we wrap up. But Gabriel, he had a condition, I think, wasn't it?
Yes, he got injured.
It's a post-war syndrome or something. It was.
Yes. He had a metal plate in his head. So
Ed,
he had that handicap, and he was Troy's brother.
Yeah. But the guy that played that that role in Fences, he was absolutely brilliant too. Brilliant.
Yes, it was well done.
It was well done. It was excellent.
Marini's Black Bottom is now on Netflix. I'm still to see it. I also did that on stage.
We'll have to have a look at that. No, so we're winding down now. Tell the viewers, what are your thoughts on Guyana, and what are your thoughts about progress in the country? What, you know, as someone who has been an artist for almost, you know, half of your lifetime, you know, say something to them that you know, that they can relate to and that they can hear coming from you. Because this program is about that. It's about connecting, you know, each other, you know, connecting us together and so on. And I am remarkably and profoundly